Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Camille Pissarro, The Audacity of Impressionism by Anka Muhlstein. Translated by Adriana Hunter. Narrated by Christine Rendel. Introduction. Camille Pissarro was a most unusual man. Granted, most artists are. But Pissarro knew that he was even more out of step with the France of his day than his peers. I have a rustic, melancholy temperament. I look coarse and wild, he acknowledged. Later, he added, too serious to appeal to the masses and too distant from exotic tradition to be understood by dilettantes. I am too surprising. I break away too often from accepted behaviour. Settled in France from the age of 25, but born in the Caribbean, he was not French, and what is more, he was Jewish. He never hid this fact, and knew that it was not without significance. He saw himself as an interloper in French society, even though he was a founding member of the New School of French Painting, was affectionately nicknamed the father of Impressionism by his peers, was a close friend of Monet, a longtime associate in Degas and Cassatt's experimental work, a support to Cezanne and Gauguin, and a comfort to Van Gogh, and was backed throughout his career by the great Parisian art dealer Paul Durand Ruel. Nevertheless, a sense of being set apart, different, and hard to classify persisted, and this is what drew me to Pissarro. He portrayed himself four times in 30 years, and his self-portraits help us form an impression of his gravitas, his calm, and the intensity of his gaze. But he also left a fifth portrait, a more detailed, more complex, and often unexpected one. The portrait constituted by his correspondence. Reading a person's correspondence is a little like eavesdropping. We are breaking and entering into the intimate world of someone who has let their guard down. The more sustained the exchange, the more personal it is, and the deeper and more nuanced the letter writer's self-portrait becomes. Camille Pissarro left a vast accumulation of letters, most of which were brought together in five volumes and edited by Janine Bailey Hertzberg. Although not exhaustive, these volumes are certainly enough to give an idea of a painter's life in the 19th century, and more specifically, of the audacity of the Impressionist adventure. But what I found most interesting about this correspondence was the self-portrait that emerges from it. Given that most of Pissarro's letters are to his children, the tone is utterly unconstrained. Pissarro did not use the familiar tu form when addressing his fellow painters, even those he had known as a student. He always showed his peers a courtesy not far removed from reserve, but abandoned all restraint, particularly in his exchanges with his eldest son. The question of religion recurs frequently over the pages. During a period of despondency, this resolute atheist admits that his origins have left their mark on him. To date, no Jew in this country has produced art, or rather heartfelt, disinterested art. I think that this could be one of the reasons I'm having no luck. This is a curious remark, insofar as he never interjected political or religious messages in his art. He good-naturedly admitted that for a Hebrew, he was far from biblical. He felt that painting should be neither literary or historical, nor political or social, but only the expression of a feeling. The fact remains, though, that he was fully conscious of the consequences of his lineage. He confesses to sometimes feeling like an outsider in France. Being not only Jewish, but also foreign, necessitated a degree of caution that did not come naturally to him. This man, who consistently demonstrated bravery in his artistic choices, who was never slow to develop or change his style, or to admit his mistakes, without ever giving way to the pressures of public demand. This man, whose personal life was characterized by an absolute refusal to accept family or social conventions. This man still knew he must never openly take part in the political battles of his time. The threat of expatriation enforced on him a reserve that he never waived. Being very sensitive to social injustice, he did whatever was within his means to support anarchist publications, but never made public les turpitudes sociales, social turpitudes, a series of striking caricatures about suffering among the working class. And although he openly sided with the Dreyfusards, he did not play such an active role in their struggle as did many of his peers, including Eugene Carrière, Edouard Viard, and the Swiss Felix Vallotton. All his energy was concentrated into his art, his children's artistic education, and the fight to have modern art recognized. He was exceptionally hard-working and left a considerable body of work. More than 1,500 oils, not to mention the pastels, watercolors, and drawings, as well as being a gifted teacher, whose four sons all went on to be respected artists. He had a tremendous talent for attracting and working closely with artists as diverse as Degas, Cezanne, Gauguin, Signac, and Seurat. Whenever the opportunity arose, he refused to comply with the demands of official art, and he, alone with Degas, participated in every Impressionist exhibition, supremely braving the insults and jeers, because he was convinced of the validity of his experimental work. Perhaps it fell to him, with his particularly independent spirit, to adopt a system that encouraged freedom and autonomy. Make your plans with no rules, or at least with none that you find offensive, he advised his son. With this, he was arguing for a new tradition, a modern one that granted artists the ability to invent, to keep re-evaluating their own work, and to justify their reputation as fierce revolutionaries. Chapter 1. St. Thomas, Paris, St. Thomas, Round Trip. Camille Pissarro was born in 1830 in St. Thomas, one of the three main Virgin Islands in the archipelago of the Lesser Antilles. A tiny island measuring 20 kilometers long by 4 wide that was under Danish rule at the time. It is difficult now to imagine how strategically and economically important these three islands, St. Thomas, the even smaller St. John, and the larger St. Croix, once were. Positioned at the intersection of various maritime routes, they gave vessels from Europe and Africa access not only to Central America, but also to North and South America. The port of St. Thomas, Charlotte Amalia, was so sought after that it was said to be the place that led to everywhere else. The port's commercial advantages were such that, over the centuries, it elicited covetous attention from the French, the English, the Dutch, and the Danes. The Spanish, led by Christopher Columbus, had been the first Europeans to land on these islands in 1493. Disappointed by the absence of gold or silver mines, they did not stay long. but the inhabitants did not survive this violent eruption and the propagation of unfamiliar germs. The islands remained uninhabited, other than by bands of pirates who attacked Spanish galleons laden with precious metals on their return to Seville and Cadiz. After several fruitless attempts thwarted by opposition from the Spanish, the English, and the French, in 1672, the Danish West India Company secured permission from the King of Denmark to found a colony on the then deserted island of St. Thomas. Almost as soon as it was established, this colony attracted British, French, Dutch, and Jewish emigrants who lived on the neighboring islands. They were fleeing the repercussions of the European War between the Dutch Republic on the one side and England and France on the other, and were seeking protection from Denmark, which had remained neutral. These newcomers set up the first cotton and sugarcane plantations, and the corollary of this was the importation of enslaved Africans. A slave market was swiftly put in place, and colonizers from other islands came here for slaves. In 1673, the population of St. Thomas ran to 100 whites and 100 blacks. In 1715, it was inventoried at 565 whites and 4,187 blacks. Over the course of the next century, the economy in St. Thomas changed. Charlotte Amalia expanded, and the island's triangular trade became so substantial that the inhabitants deemed it more lucrative to leave sugarcane cultivation to colonizers on the nearby island of St. Croix, which Denmark had bought from France in 1733, and devote themselves entirely to the slave trade. The English seized the island during the Napoleonic Wars, but in 1815 they signed an accord with Denmark, which took back possession of the island that same year and made it a free port. A great variety of import-export companies, large and small, English, French, Italian, Spanish, and German, set up shop, and the atmosphere on the island became more cosmopolitan. The tenor of the population altered too. The cruel practice of slavery continued on St. Croix, where 90% of the population was enslaved, but declined in St. Thomas, where sugar cultivation was gradually phased out. There was, however, still a considerable number of slaves in domestic service. Camille Pissarro's mother, Rachel Pomi Manzana, was born in St. Thomas in 1795. Nothing is known about her family's history. Her parents or grandparents, who were Sephardic Jews, had left France at the end of the 18th century, initially to set up home in San Domingo, then in St. Thomas in 1791. Meanwhile, Camille's father, Frederick Pissarro, was born in France, and his paternal grandfather, a Portuguese Sephardic Jew, in Braganza. Portugal, like Spain, had been persecuting Jews since the 16th century, and the constant threat of the Inquisition forced many to live as Christians while practicing their true religion in absolute secrecy. These Maranos, as they were known, fled Portugal at the first opportunity, which is how, in 1769, the Pissarros managed to reach Bordeaux, a city that was very open to overseas trade and had been welcoming and protecting Portuguese Jews since the reign of Henri II. On payment of a tax, they secured the right to practice their religion openly and to exercise whatever trade they chose. Portuguese Jews constituted the most flourishing Jewish community in 18th century France. They specialized in industry, and in particular, the processing of commodities from the colonies. The Grades, the most prosperous family in the Nassau, the Sephardic community, had a monopoly on sugar, and the D'Acostas on chocolate, which was introduced to France by the Jewish community in Bayonne. Other opportunities for accruing wealth were offered by banking, outfitting ships, insurance, and most significantly, by trading in slaves and freight heading for colonies in the Americas. Joseph Gabriel Pissarro settled in Bordeaux's trading community and married a local Jewish woman, Anne Felicity Petit. When their son Frederick was born in 1802, he was entirely French because Jews had been emancipated in 1791. The family prospered, and like many Jewish families, extended its activities over the Atlantic. As part of this expansion, Joseph Gabriel's brother-in-law, Isaac Petit, set sail for the West Indies and settled in St. Thomas, joining one of the most populous and complex Jewish communities in the New World. The first synagogue on the island was built in 1796. It was destroyed by fire in 1804. A second synagogue was erected in 1812, but was very soon outgrown and replaced by a third. In 1823, the town was ravaged by fire, and the Jews had to build yet another new place of worship. It was completed in 1833, and this synagogue is still standing. It has kept its original furnishings and the custom of spreading sand over the floorboards as a reminder of the days when the Muranos had to stifle every sound during their services. It is one of the two oldest synagogues in the Americas. The Jews in St. Thomas were not a homogeneous group. A Sephardic element that had originated in Bordeaux and Bayonne and was intermingled with Spanish and Portuguese immigrants lived alongside families of Dutch extraction, formerly based in Curaçao, and a small number of Danish Ashkenazi Jews. At the time, Jews constituted one quarter of the white population, a population that had always been extremely diverse. A 1688 census noted that inhabitants with European roots came from 11 different countries. The population included American and Danish Protestants, as well as a sizable Roman Catholic faction. St. Thomas and its trading activities drew in a good many Venezuelans and other Central Americans. The official religion was the Lutheran Church, as in Denmark. It goes without saying that the great majority of inhabitants were black. The phasing out of plantations had given some of them the opportunity to live as free men, either because they had been released from slavery, or, more commonly, because they had bought their freedom. They earned their livings as craftsmen, shopkeepers, or clerks. An 1834 decree from King Frederick VI gave citizenship to all free blacks, along with the same rights and privileges as white inhabitants. But it took one final slave rebellion on the island of St. Croix for slavery to be abolished at last in 1847. When he arrived on the island in about 1810, Isaac Petit married Esther Manzana Pommy. Esther died young, and true to Jewish tradition, Isaac then married her younger sister Rachel, who was some 20 years his junior. They set up home in Charlotte Amalia to take advantage of the three-way trading arrangements between Europe, the United States, and Latin America. Isaac Petit soon found himself running an extremely lucrative warehouse for a variety of goods. The business was flourishing when he died in 1824. Pregnant with a fourth child, distraught and unable to run the company, Rachel turned to her late husband's family. The business was too profitable to be left to founder, so the French family swiftly sent out someone to help the widow, young Frederick Pissarro, Isaac's nephew, whom the latter had, in fact, appointed as the executor of his will. His aunt's welcome went beyond his expectations. In the spring of 1825, she was pregnant again and gave birth to a son, Felix, causing a scandal in the community. It may have been common for an uncle to marry his niece, but for a nephew to seduce his aunt, even if only by marriage, and especially when she was 7 years his senior, was deemed inadmissible. Rachel and Frederick took no heed of this. Furthermore, Felix's birth, coming so soon after the arrival of Isaac's last child, proved that they had contravened the Jewish law stipulating that a man may not have relations with a woman who is breastfeeding a newborn. The synagogue, therefore, did not grant them permission to marry. They proceeded regardless and exchanged their vows in a private house before a minyan, a group of 10 adult Jews that was essential for the recitation of prayers and hence for any religious ceremony. The young couple announced they were married in the newspaper. But the synagogue in St. Thomas did not accept this fait accompli and refused to recognize the marriage. It even went so far as to run a large display notice in the same newspaper, the St. Thomas Tuner, to state categorically that the synagogue's authorities, the rulers and wardens of the synagogue, did not accept it. The synagogue in Copenhagen supported this decision. By contrast, the civil administration recorded the marriage. But the Petit family in Bordeaux, concerned that they might lose their business to a Pissarro nephew, announced that they were against the union. It was a complicated matter, and the dispute continued for 8 years. The synagogue finally yielded in 1833. After the King of Denmark intervened, having been asked to settle this thorny question once and for all. In the meantime, three more sons had been born. Moise Alfred in 1829, Jacob Camille in 1830, and Aaron Gustav in 1833. As a result of this long controversy, the children attended neither the Hebrew school nor the Christian school. The scandal caused by their parents' union was not confined to the Jewish community. There is no doubting that the tiny white community was hungry for malicious gossip, and the Pissarro boys would not have been comfortable alongside children from these families. They took classes at the Moravian school, where lessons were taught in English by missionaries, and where most of the students were black children. The school had been founded to convert and educate them. It was here that Camille acquired a perfect knowledge of English, along with an unusual self-assurance and immunity to prejudice in the world around him. He also escaped the intolerance typical of many small religious communities. The Pissarro boys would certainly have been excused from religious instruction given by the missionaries. But bearing in mind the synagogue's attitude toward their parents, it is not at all clear whether they received any Jewish instruction. Camille Pissarro never made any mention of a bar mitzvah. His parents remained attached to their respective father's tradition, but their circumstances did not facilitate passing it on. The Pissarros lived over the shop, which was usually crammed with merchandise, in a house that stands to this day. It has been named the Camille Pissarro Building and is now a gallery. When Camille was a child, it must have felt very small for Rachel's 8 children. She was helped by 2 slaves and other servants, but her capricious moods provoked frequent storms. Within the family, the day-to-day language was French. English was spoken mostly for business affairs. Danish, which was used only for settling administrative matters, was not common. The father of the family, Frederick, remained in close contact with his parents, brothers, and cousins who had stayed in France. And Rachel considered herself French, even though her family had settled in America in the course of the previous century. When the time came to complete the boy's education, it was decided as a matter of course that they should go to boarding school in Paris, where their paternal grandparents had moved from Bordeaux. Camille was 11 when he set out on a sailing ship for Le Havre with his older brother Alfred. They would spend 6 years as boarders at Savary School in Passy, which was then practically in the countryside. Savary Boarding School dated back to the Ancien Régime, and like many similar institutions, had abandoned central Paris in favour of fresh air. Of course, the great majority of masters and pupils were Roman Catholic. And once again, the Pissarro boys found themselves, if not in an awkward situation, at least in the unusual position of receiving no religious instruction. This decision of their parents and grandparents can first be explained by the fact that there were no Jewish boarding schools in Paris at the time. Besides, the boys had never been subjected to Jewish authorities. And lastly, the family probably considered that the instruction at Savary would better prepare them for French customs, should they ever decide to settle in France. In any event, Camille and his brother Alfred do not appear to have suffered during their time at the boarding school. The curriculum of classical education was balanced between humanities and sciences, and the masters regularly took their pupils to the Louvre. Camille was therefore introduced to art when he was very young, and if his father's complaints are to be believed, he showed only a tepid interest in mathematics. One of the greatest etchers of the time, Charles Merion, had attended the school a few years before the Pissarro boys and was always grateful to the headmaster, Auguste Savary's younger brother, for introducing him to drawing. This same Mr. Savary, who had a good reputation as a painter, took an interest in Camille, encouraged him, invited him to visit his studio, and, although he himself never worked en plein air, particularly recommended that he should always pay close attention to the natural world and draw as many coconut trees as possible during his vacations. But because the crossing took about 3 weeks, it seems unlikely that the children could go home to their parents over the summer. Their grandparents and one of their uncles, Moïse, who had a large family of his own, took them in. In 1847, having completed their education, they left their boarding school, where they had made a good impression. Many years later, one of Camille's sons, Lucien, met a very friendly old spinster, Mademoiselle Picard, who remembered his father in Passy and had even kept a few sketches of her parents that he had drawn for her. Back in St. Thomas, Camille and Alfred started working, though with little enthusiasm, alongside their father. The business was growing, and they were actively involved, but their thoughts were elsewhere. They had had a taste of another life, a life spent visiting museums and galleries, going to concerts, and discovering how huge Paris was and how varied its neighbourhoods. Alfred could think only of playing the violin, and Camille of drawing. Two cousins shared their frustration and were hatching plans to escape. One of them, Jules Cardoz, longed to write novels. The other, Raoul Panet, dreamed of living an artist's life in Paris. Whenever he could get away, Camille spent time strolling through the streets and along the docks. He had clearly not forgotten his French teacher's advice and studied people and things around him. A few sketches of young children playing in the street date from this period, as well as a more detailed drawing of a woman patching an item of clothing. But the most accomplished drawing was of a coconut tree, he regretted having so little time to himself, and was mostly kept busy overseeing the unloading of cargo and keeping the accounts for his father's warehouse. He found these responsibilities crushingly boring. Deliverance came in the form of a traveller, a Danish painter called Fritz Melby, who landed in Charlotte Amalia in 1851. Chapter 2. Rudderless Adventure in Venezuela. Fritz Melby, a tall, handsome Dane, had come to St. Thomas in search not of a fortune, but of new landscapes. It would surely not have been long before he noticed a young man who paced the docks, sketchbook in hand. The two artists quickly became acquainted. Melby enjoyed a freedom that must have appeared boundless to Camille. His training had begun alongside his brother Anton, a pupil of Corot, who painted seascapes and whose work was highly valued in France. Another brother, Wilhelm, who also painted seascapes, lived in England. At 23, Fritz had enough self-confidence to leave Denmark. He never returned. He set off to discover the Americas with sufficient resources to roam the New World, encouraged by his artist family, who set no constraints on his travels. What is more, his travels were justified by a mission entrusted to him by the Danish government to inventory indigenous plants. He was only 4 years older than Camille, but when their paths crossed, he had considerably more experience. His work had already been exhibited in Copenhagen, and he had no trouble selling his American landscapes, which seemed so exotic to his fellow countrymen, and which he regularly dispatched back to Europe. The two artists, whose common language was English, were soon inseparable. They were always seen together, often drawing somewhere around the harbour. Camille made the most of his friend's advice and of the example he set. He was encouraged by the fact that Fritz could survive off his painting. Within no time, Charlotte, Amalia, and the surrounding area could no longer satisfy their curiosity, and they made plans to leave St. Thomas and explore Venezuela. Despite his impatience, Camille did not allow himself to act on impulse. His brother Alfred was in France at the time, and he knew that his father needed one of his sons there to ensure that the business ran smoothly. He would have to wait for Alfred's return then. He resigned himself to waiting. This patience and readiness to find a compromise, to take into account other people's needs, and to respect family responsibilities, all unusual qualities in a young man as passionate as he was, are the most endearing aspects of his personality. A letter from Fritz dated April 1852 and sent from the nearby island of St. Croix gives details of the preparations for their adventure. Camille must, he advised, stock up on materials. Paints, canvases, pencils, and paper might not be easy to find along the way. Camille had no trouble getting hold of them. The Pissarro firm sold everything. At last, in October 1852, the two young men boarded a French ship due to stop over in La Guayra, the port of Caracas, where they found lodgings in an inn. Years later, Pissarro was intoxicated by memories of this departure and allowed himself some liberties with the details when he wrote to his friend Eugene Murat, a colourful character who was a great admirer of the Impressionists and who will be mentioned again later. As a paid assistant in St. Thomas in 1852, I dropped everything without a moment's thought and fled to Caracas to break the cable that tethered me to bourgeois life. I don't think I would have any hesitation if I had to do the same thing again. The frustration of being unable to spend hours on end painting and drawing in St. Thomas had been a decisive factor in his desire for escape. And from the moment he was free, he never stopped working. He produced hundreds of works on paper in the next 2 years he spent in Latin America. Many examples of them can be seen in the Caracas Museum of Fine Arts, in private collections in Venezuela, and at the Olana State Historic Site in Hudson, New York, which houses an archive that Melby entrusted to his friend, the famous landscape artist Frank Church, before he travelled to China, where he died in 1869. The two artists frequently set up their easels side by side. Melby gave snippets of advice to the younger man, but Camille appears to have found his own eye at a very early stage. And during his time in France, he had acquired sufficient technique and ability to give him the freedom to be creative without copying his companion. Despite his lack of experience, he was not unduly influenced by Melby. Besides, they did not always view the object of their interest in the same way. Melby's mission required an accuracy in the depictions of plants that does not appear in Camille's work. It is not that the latter neglected the details of a flower or a leaf, but he was primarily interested in the overall structure of a drawing and had already stopped prioritizing line over color. Their concepts of landscapes were different too. Let us take as an example a watercolor of Camille's that depicts the small harbor of La Guiara. As he always would, he put a number of figures in the scene. A woman carrying a large earthenware jar on her head, a man on a donkey, talking to a child, a couple in the distance in conversation, and another out for a walk. Camille would never lose this partiality to the human aspect of a scene. After a trip to Arca in the Pas-de-Calais at the end of his life, he wrote to his son, "The countryside doesn't suit me. It's mostly sweeping, when what I'm after is little nooks." Melby, on the other hand, liked sketching vast expanses that would serve as frameworks for larger paintings. Nevertheless, Camille certainly benefited from their close working relationship and enjoyed this unstructured connection between peers, which, as we shall learn, he recreated throughout his life. Having exhausted the possibilities around the small port, the two young men set out for the capital, Caracas. Camille had already spent nearly 6 years in the great city of Paris, but nothing could have prepared him for a city like Caracas. An agglomeration of 250,000 inhabitants with origins all over the world, their forefathers having mixed freely with the indigenous population. The European element, mostly descended from Spanish colonizers, may well have been a minority, but it dominated political and intellectual life and had imposed Spanish as the country's official language, along with some of its old-world institutions. The citizens of Caracas took pride in having a university, a theatre, and even an academy of drawing and music that was sufficiently modern in its outlook to make time for teaching Degas' photographic techniques. Camille explored the extensive stocks of the city's bookshops, which often included rich pickings of French publications. One shop sold beautiful engravings by François Girard, Horace Vernet, Léon Cogniet, and Louis Giraudet, painters whose works Camille would almost certainly have seen in Paris. The city's grandest hotel, the Posada Europa, opened its lounges for concerts, during which a violinist from the Paris Opera played with Venezuelan musicians. It was there that Pissarro discovered Chopin, Offenbach and Bellini. In no time, the musicians had adopted the two painters and even suggested that they contribute to a reenactment of a Venetian banquet, complete with a choir. But what made them happiest was the backdrop provided by daily life in Caracas, a scene characterized by perpetual motion. At first light, peasants arrived at the market on donkeys and set out their produce. As soon as it was all sold, noisy celebrations, complete with singing and dancing, began in the multitude of taverns. Come evening, the smallholders set off back to their fields. Alongside this, there was the endless political agitation of a country that had wrenched its independence from Spain at the turn of the century, but had failed to find any viable equilibrium. This turbulent climate did not stop the two travellers from settling in comfortably. They rented a house near Plaza Mayor and set to work. A coloured pencil drawing by Pissarro shows them in a well-furnished studio, cluttered with canvases, with just one portrait visible among many landscapes. A little boy is drawing under the watchful gaze of Camille, who is probably giving the child a lesson. The prospect of earning a living without abandoning painting was exhilarating. The two painters were not short of students, and they were sought after for portraits. Their rapport never wavered throughout their stay here. Although Melby was more experienced than Camille at the time, it is difficult to interpret theirs as a student-teacher relationship. In the considerable archive that Melby left at Olana, their landscapes and small-scale oils are not always easy to attribute to one or the other. Throughout his life, Camille would maintain similarly loose partnerships based on reciprocal influence with fellow artists. In fact, when many years later he worked alongside Cezanne, Gauguin, Degas and Seurat, it would be difficult to establish who was the master and who the student. In Pissarro's mind, there was no hierarchy. Any exchanges with his colleagues were always typified by equality. He was quite indifferent to discrepancies in age. This taste for freedom in human relationships, which would so manifest in his attitude toward his own children, constantly evolved. Over the course of this trip in his youth, Pissarro identified what he liked to paint and what went on to interest him his whole life. Markets, animated groups of people, and occupations rather than faces. He was drawn to everyday scenes, usually out of doors, women washing clothes in a stream or cooking a meal on a brazier, always with other figures in the background. One of the most accomplished drawings, a sepia entitled Danse de Carnaval, is so exuberant, so vigorous, that the beat of the music seems to emanate from it. Already, he was not striving to prettify, be sentimental, or make any political judgment. He painted what he saw. He was very comfortable speaking Spanish, having learned the rudiments in St. Thomas, and he became friends with a group of Venezuelan painters who, like him, recognized Melby's technical superiority. These artists, Mariano Palacio, Rafael Herrera, and Miguel Roma, went on excursions together and discovered the natural wonders of tropical forests and spectacular waterfalls. Sketches of Camille made by his friends show him happy and focused. He is very handsome, relaxed-looking, and already sports a Van Dyck-style beard. These would be his only years of true freedom, far from family constraints and free of any financial worries. When I was young, Like everyone else, I was left to my own devices. In a foreign country, free, absolutely free. And I was lucky never to meet with difficult circumstances, he wrote to his son nearly 50 years later. It is worth pointing out that he produced nearly 600 sheets of drawings and a significant number of very varied oil paintings during this period. This thoroughly happy and rewarding life was interrupted when he received a letter from his brother Alfred. Their younger brother, Gustave, had just died, aged 20, and their mother was being submerged by grief and depression. She had already lost 3 children in infancy. This latest blow was a crushing one. Alfred described her sobbing, pacing the corridor outside Gustave's bedroom, as if hoping he would reappear. She was in no state to support or console her other children. And Alfred ended his letter by insisting that Camille return home, because he, Alfred, so desperately needed a friend. The pain and loneliness were killing him. This was the first glimpse of Rachel Pissarro's character and her emotional fragility, which would weigh so heavily on her children. Not a word about their father in Alfred's letter. Responsibility for Rachel's frame of mind seemed to fall more on her children than her husband. Camille had broken ties with bourgeois life, but not with family. Nevertheless, having learned that his mother intended to leave St. Thomas and move permanently to France, he stayed on in Venezuela for a few more months. He struggled to resign himself to ending such a successful sojourn, but in the meantime, he and his father reached a compromise. He would return to St. Thomas and replace Alfred, who had left for Paris, where he hoped to have several months of well-deserved vacation. Camille committed to working for his father for a year. Then he would be free to leave and try his chances as an artist in Paris. And so he left Caracas in August 1854 and resumed his position in the family business, while still maintaining contact with Melby. Meanwhile, his mother and 2 half-sisters had left the island in favour of Europe. The eldest, Emma, had recently married Phineas Isaacson, a merchant from a Jewish St. Thomas family of English origin, who had set up a company in England with offshoots in St. Thomas. She intended to make her home in London, while her mother and sister, Delphine, would stay in Paris. This wholesale move was justified. Camille's father anticipated that steamboats, which were making the Atlantic crossing in ever greater numbers, would reduce the strategic importance of the islands, meaning his business would need to adapt. The port of Charlotte Amalia was too small for large modern boats to manoeuvre. It was becoming clear that this stopover would soon be dropped, so it was useful to establish strong ties in Europe. On a personal note, Rachel had a rather abstract nostalgia for France, given that she had never lived there, but she was glad to leave the island and the devastating memories of Gustave's death, briefly leaving behind her husband and one of her sons. So it was that Camille was left treading water in St. Thomas for a whole year. When at last he could set sail for Europe, he never regained the freedom of the young bachelor who had embarked on a Venezuelan adventure 3 years earlier. Family commitments would weigh heavily on him his entire life, and a more serious apprenticeship as a painter would show him just how much work there was for him to do. Chapter 3. Paris, One-Way Ticket. Camille Pissarro arrived in Paris in October 1855. In fact, he first landed in Southampton and intended to spend a few days in London. But there was a letter from his sister Emma waiting for him. She begged him to come to Paris as a matter of urgency. Their sister Delphine was dying. Their mother Rachel was stricken. And Emma herself, overwhelmed by the demands of four young children, needed help. Her husband, Phineas Isaacson, was in London, and her aged grandparents constituted her only support, and rather shaky support at that.
"We are alone here, without a man to help us."
The era of responsibilities was beginning. Camille did not hesitate. He left for Paris immediately. Room was made for him in the family apartment on the Rue Notre-Dame de Lorette. This was in the heart of the neighbourhood that attracted painters and writers. But this choice of location is more readily explained by the fact that very close by, on the Rue Lamartine, was the Portuguese Jews' synagogue. The Portuguese Sephardim had settled in Paris before the Ashkenazim, but were fewer in number, and for a long time had had access only to oratories rather than a true synagogue. Having their own place of worship was so important to them that when the large Ashkenazi synagogue on the Rue de la Victoire was built in 1874, they refused to join it and remained independent. Not much could be done for the unfortunate Delphine, who died in December. But it was clear that Rachel, transplanted into a city with more than 1 million inhabitants and thrown into a frenetic pace of life, needed help. Luckily, the Pissarros were well off. The smooth running of the household was ensured by a nanny, a chambermaid, a cook, and a kitchen girl. The paternal grandparents were well used to life in the capital and explained Parisian customs to them. Camille was very soon able to have a life of his own, a life entirely governed by his passion for art. In 1855, Paris, under the Second Empire, was in a state of effervescence. There was construction in progress everywhere. Baron Haussmann was transforming the city, dismantling the ancient maze of streets, creating wide arterial roads, and raising slums to the ground. The whole centre of Paris, comprising a warren of insalubrious and overpopulated streets, was opened up. The city that Pissarro discovered was more like the Paris we know now than the one he had known during his first stay. One of his most famous views of Paris, painted late in his life in 1898, is of the Avenue de l'Opéra, one of the newly laid roads intended to link the grand boulevards to the Louvre and the Rue de Rivoli. Not only were the capital's appearance and daily life changing, but its artistic life was also evolving. Honoré de Balzac died in 1850, just as Émile Zola moved to Paris from Aix-en-Provence. Eugène Delacroix and Jean-Auguste Dominique Ingres were at the height of their careers, but had only a few years left to live. By contrast, Camille Corot was in full possession of his faculties, and along with his peers, Jean-François Millet, Charles-François d'Aubigny, and Narcisse Diaz, was launching plein air painting in the forest of Fontainebleau around Barbizon. Edouard Manet and Edgar Degas were beginning their apprenticeships, Manet in Thomas Couture's studio, Degas at the École des Beaux-Arts, the National School of Fine Arts. Jacques Offenbach was creating a new genre, operetta, which would enjoy resounding and lasting success, meaning that a German-Jewish immigrant to France would come to define the high spirits and frivolity of the Belle Époque. This was a far cry from St. Thomas and Caracas. Camille surrendered happily to an exciting atmosphere so perfectly matched to his own tastes that he never felt the need to return to the Americas, and does not appear to have missed the sunshine, the light, or the ocean there. Bouts of bitterly cold weather. It was minus 11 degrees Fahrenheit in Paris in the winter of 1879. Made no difference to him. On the other hand, he complained all his life about spikes of torrid heat through which he suffered in Île-de-France. And he never joined Paul Cezanne or Claude Monet on their frequent trips to work in the south of France. He always preferred Normandy's soft, damp tones and the effect that rain had on the city, and did not allow himself to be influenced by his dealer, Paul Durand Ruel, who often reminded him that sun-drenched paintings were more likely to tempt buyers. He personally liked wintry hues. In a letter, he told his friend the critic, Theodore Dure, "There is nothing colder than strong summer sun. Quite at odds with the colourists, nature is colourful in winter and cold in summer." He never renounced this way of seeing things. "I can't bear summer," he admitted to his son Lucien in 1893, "with all its monotonous green, its dry, distant expanses where you can see everything, the torment of stifling heat, the sluggishness and sleepiness. Artistic feelings come back to life in September and October." During his twilight years, in 1901, convinced that there were more flowers in fall than in springtime, he wrote to one of his last dealers, Bernheim Jun, about his painting, Autumn in the Meadow at Aragny, saying that its trees are decked in dead leaves that burst out like flowers in the sunlight. Hardly surprising, then, that he never wanted to return to the tropics. Paris certainly provided the young man with stimulating possibilities. But also, by great good fortune, he had arrived a few days before the end of the Exposition Universelle World's Fair. 4 years earlier, London's Great Exhibition, the first in a series of fairs and exhibitions that would punctuate the 19th century, had been an astounding success, with its 6 million visitors. But that exhibition had been devised primarily to glorify industrial art and English manufacturing. In Paris, fine arts had been given such prominence that a temporary building had been erected on Avenue Montaigne to exhibit some 5,000 works. Ingres and Delacroix dominated the collection with 43 and 35 paintings respectively. Pissarro later said that he spent at least 4 days viewing everything. He enjoyed discovering the landscape painters Daubigny, Theodore Rousseau, and Diaz, and most particularly...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.